Good evening to everybody. Croeso cynnes iawn I chi I gyd I ddarlith rithriol arall gan y Comisiwn. Heno, bydd Hayley Roberts yn trafod treftadau llongdrylliadau, gwerthoedd bygythiadau a phensiynau cyfreithiol. A very warm welcome to you all to another Comisiwn online lecture. Tonight, Hayley Roberts will be talking about shipwrecked heritage, values, threats and legal tensions. You're welcome to ask any questions. Hayley will be happy to answer them. But could you please write your questions in the Q&A function? We'd be grateful if you don't use the chat for questions. Thanks. This evening's talk will be recorded and shared on other platforms. For those not watching this live, you're also welcome to send us any questions or share your comments. And Hayley will reply to them as soon as possible. Erbi the sgwrs hon drwy gyfrwng y Saesneg heno, cofiwch fod croeso I chi gysylltu â ni yn y Gymraeg os ydych chi'n am ofyn cwestiwn neu adael sylw. Hoffwn naw gyflwyno ein siaradwr heno, sef Hayley Roberts. Mae Hayley yn wchddarlithydd mewn cyfraith rhwngwladol cyhoeddus ym Mhrifysgol Bangor ac yn is-cadet gadeirydd y Comisiwn Brenhinol. Mae ei diddordebau o ran ymchwil yn ymwneud yn bennaf â chyfraith rhwngwladol y môr, yn enwedig treftadaeth diwylliannol dan dŵr a'r newid yn y hinsawdd. Ar hyn o bryd mae hi'n ysgrifennu monograff sy'n dwyn y teitl State-owned Shipwrecks and International Law a gyhoeddi'r y flwyddyn nesaf. Hayley is a senior lecturer in public international law at Bangor University and is vice chair of the Royal Commission. Her research interests mainly relate to the international law of the sea, particularly underwater cultural heritage and climate change. She is currently writing a monograph entitled State-owned Shipwrecks in International Law to be published next year. Felly, a hynny o eiria drosodd I Hayley.
Diolch yn fawr, Dave. Just check before I start that everything is fine and you can see the slides and I can't see Zoom at the minute, so just checking.
Yeah, it all looks good to me.
Fantastic, thank you very much. Diolch yn fawr, and I'm very happy to take questions in Welsh, so hapus iawn I gymryd cwestiynau yn y Gymraeg wedyn, os sari yw'n eisiau gofyn. So yes, international law. So I'm an international lawyer specialising in the law of the sea, as you've just heard, with an interest in underwater cultural heritage, particularly interested in shipwrecks and within that as a kind of a subset, wrecked warships. So I'm interested in law and policy that manages or relates to these wrecks. And law can get a little bit technical and let's admit it, a little bit dry. For this talk, I wanted something that felt a little bit more accessible, a little bit more interesting. It's a late night talk. You want to get a cup of tea and just kind of be able to get absorbed in something. So for this talk, I wanted to do something that does have relevancy for law, but allows me to talk about some of the things that really interest me about wrecks. And I get to use some photos as well. So looking at different values, I felt really allows me to do that. And in this talk, I'm not really trying to change the way we consider heritage values or even explore the bigger question of what heritage values are. I'd probably leave that to the heritage experts. And being a lawyer will probably be my get out of jail free card tonight for any difficult questions. But I just want to simply explore the different values that shipwrecks have. And in doing so, I want to identify some of these values, some of you which you may not have considered before, the different ways in which wrecks can be valuable to us. So I'll highlight some examples using Welsh examples, example from Wales where possible. And I'll also touch on some things that can threaten these values and note how these different values can provoke some challenging legal situations when it comes to managing shipwrecks. I'm not going to dive too deeply into the law in the very short time that we have, but I will touch on that a little bit. As you heard, I'm writing a book on state-owned shipwrecks and international law, and this is one of the first chapters in the book, so you're the first audience to hear about it, and so it might be some really good feedback for me as well. I really, really enjoyed researching this chapter, so I really hope that you find the topic interesting as well. So there are lots been written on heritage values. And again, I'm not trying to open a debate on values in general. So this is just really to give some context to the talk. So I suppose one of the first principles and a good place to start is the idea that society makes no effort to preserve what it doesn't value. And as Baba Diouf, a famous Senegalese environmentalist, said, we conserve only what we love. And that makes absolute sense, doesn't it? Why would we put our efforts into preserving something that we don't really care about in the first place? So I think that gives us an idea of how values might factor into the way that we manage and conserve our heritage. And when we talk about value, we're really talking about the meaning that either individuals or groups ascribe to heritage. And that's often related to worth or significance, not necessarily monetary worth. It doesn't have to be a pound value, but it might be worthwhile in lots of different ways. So a values-based approach does encourage engagement with values and perspectives that go beyond the academic. So beyond academics and experts looking at heritage and ascribing values to that. Because recent years have seen new stakeholder groups engaged with heritage, which is fantastic to see. So that feels like there's a little bit of a shift away from valuation exclusively by experts. Of course, that is still a big important part of that process, but really moving towards public and societal views. So there's now a recognition of things like social benefits, including ethnic dignity, economic development, spiritual life, social stability. So some of these ideas we might touch upon. So what is the connection between values and law and policy? So where do the lawyers come in? Well, values can signify the importance of heritage. It tells us what kinds of laws we might need to conserve and manage the heritage. If we know what's important and how it's important, then we know better how to protect it. But this can be quite challenging. So the values of different groups and different people can often be quite incompatible. So they can clash, and that results in some quite serious conflicts. The assessment and prioritization of heritage values can be challenging, and it can be quite a subjective process. And that undoubtedly leads to some discussion of heritage significance. So that's the overall sum of heritage value and the sum of identified heritage value. So while it's really good to see this evolution in valuation towards kind of societal and public views, it does significantly increase the complexities in dealing with heritage. And we know that values can change over time. So there might become a time where something is no longer valued or its values are contested. So for example, legacies to slavery. So in the picture here, we have the statue of Edward Colston being toppled in Bristol in 2020. And there are Ukraine after the fall of the Soviet Union. So society changes, and so do our values. But values are still really important, because giving values a role in law and policy enables an assessment again of how and to whom a wreck is significant, and it allows the identification of potential threats. So if we know how something is valuable, then we might know in what ways it could be threatened. And also, we also can identify the applicability of different legal regimes. So if something has a historical value, then we know that some laws that relate to heritage could be applicable to that. So getting to the point, what are the values of shipwrecks generally? When we think about historic shipwrecks and how to conserve and manage them, we tend to think of their historical value primarily, because we tend to think of them as historic shipwrecks. But shipwrecks can have considerable value beyond the archaeological. And this here is not meant to be an exhaustive list, and it is really quite general. So specific wrecks will have specific values. So this is just, I guess, an overview of looking at some of those. So what I'd like to do is, over the course of the next 40 minutes or so, look at each of these in turn and give some examples to show, to kind of reflect the value, and look at some of these, the threats to those values, and then look at some legal issues within those as well. I had so many examples, I had real trouble narrowing them down to fit into my allotted time. So I'm hoping I've chosen the best examples for you. So we have commemorative, personal and emotional value, national, historical value, communal and social, environmental, economic and commercial, and scientific. So let's start with commemorative, personal and emotional value. So there's keen public interest in commemorating historical events, and particularly those that relate to war in general. We commemorate Remembrance Day every single year. Memorials have been erected in cities, towns, villages, all over the world, remembering those who died in armed conflict. So this gives wrecked warships in particular significant commemorative value. And the example that I've used here is the memorial in Holyhead on Anglesey, which is not that far away from me. And for many communities and individuals, these wrecks will also have personal or emotional value. We want to acknowledge the wrecks, the victims, the survivors, and their stories. So the Royal Commission's U-Boat project was a fantastic project that supported coastal communities around Wales to tell their previously untold stories about World War I wrecks around Wales, and creating a human record of those wrecks and the people that died on them. So the stories in this particular project reflect that emotional and personal value. For example, William Roberts' story. So he was only 17 when he died after the boat that he was on was torpedoed by a German U-boat. And his obituary really brings home the human tragedy represented by these wrecks. So written by his family, the joy from our household is gone. The voice we loved is stilled. The place is vacant on our hearts, which can never be filled. So we can clearly see that there, you know, it makes you feel emotional. It gives you this personal connection to this wreck that you might never have heard of previously. These stories bring these wrecks to life. So there's considerable emotional and personal value there. We might even view these wrecks as war graves. So we know that human remains can be found quite some time after a ship sinks. And bones have been found on wrecks as old as 2,000 years old. And many wrecked warships, submarines in particular, are really likely to contain human remains because of their nature. Submarines keep water out, but they keep bodies and souls in. And 89,000 men and women were killed just from the British Navy alone in the First World War. And so we believe that these wrecks containing their remains merit sensitive treatment. We want to respect their sacrifice. We want to safeguard their legacies. There was outcry during the salvage of the HMS Edinburgh, seen afloat here, when salvors were alleged to have placed glow sticks inside the skulls on the wreck to scare other divers. But the idea of a maritime war grave is quite legally challenging, actually. So first, it is challenging to guarantee that there would be no interference with that wreck site if it is designated as a grave. The wreck would probably need to be kept in situ where it is as a war grave, and that could conflict with other values that wreck might have. And in some cases, it might even clash with the protection of the marine environment if that wreck has to be recovered and brought up to the surface or altered. As we'll see a little later, without giving too much away now. Secondly, there's no real concept of a maritime war grave in international law, and that makes it really difficult to argue that these sites should be treated in a certain way as war graves by all states, no matter where their location. So states will often have their own national laws that aim to designate war graves. For example, the UK has the Protection of Military Remains Act 1986. And this act effectively allows the UK to designate war graves even when they're not in UK waters. But the issue is, UK law is, of course, only applicable to UK ships and UK territory and inhabitants. So the, Protection of Military Remains Act is not going to be applicable in other states. Domestic laws don't really give a legal guarantee that the wreck site is going to be internationally respected. In order to do that, we have to look to other legal regimes. And although I'm not going to touch on this too much in this particular talk, we will be looking at some of those regimes under other values. So in terms of national value, some shipwrecks were previously owned or operated by states, like warships, for example. So they do have clear national value. They're prominent national symbols and memorials. So the image at the bottom of this slide is the Pearl Harbor National Memorial. And that includes the memorials of Arizona, Utah, and Oklahoma, commemorating the attack on Pearl Harbor. There also might be state-owned shipwrecks might also have national value for national security reasons. Although as given that technology and intelligence can develop very quickly, that argument, the national security argument, may be less valid as time goes on. Because as time goes on, naturally intelligence and technology can get old very quickly. And to be honest, state interference with a foreign state's wreck in peacetime is really quite rare, but it isn't unheard of. So in 1984, the US actually recovered in secret parts of a Soviet submarine in the photo above on the slide pre-sinking, including the bodies of six men. This was a CIA project, and you might have heard it referred to as Project Azorian. Of course, that was during kind of Cold War era as well. This national value can throw up questions of sovereign immunity. So immunity is a key concept in international law, where states are given immunity from jurisdiction of foreign courts. So states can't be prosecuted or sued in the courts of other states. The idea is that states should be able to carry out their business and international relations unhindered. And this immunity also reflects the idea that all states are equal in international law. That immunity extends to high-ranking officials and diplomatic property. You've probably heard of diplomatic immunity, but this also applies to warships and government-owned vessels. But it's been really less certain whether this immunity applies to wrecked warships. So whether that immunity continues after the ship has sunk. And many states do believe that wrecked warships do retain their immunity, as do I, but it's not confirmed as a principle of international law yet. So it might not be enforceable as international law. But in any case, immunity is unlikely to continue if a state has passed on title. In other words, if they've sold the wreck, which did happen quite a lot after the war. There have been evidence of people salvaging wrecks from the Battle of Jutland in the North Sea, and the UK saying that they can't act as immunity has been lost because they've sold the shipwrecks. So although there may be immunity for wrecked warships, it would probably be wise not to rely on it as the sole means of protection and counting on the fact that people will leave wrecks alone because of it. This next one is perhaps the most obvious for historic shipwrecks, their historical value. So they can be valuable in different ways in terms of historical, cultural and archaeological value. And the first point that I have there is shipwrecks don't discriminate. So the written record can be imprecise if history was written to be favourable to a certain monarch or a country or critical of another. So, for example, the Vikings are often depicted as these murderous, barbaric people, although academics now believe that they were really no more murderous than other warriors of their time. It's just that their victims might have written a lot of the accounts. And in the Battle of Agincourt, quite famously, Henry V's victorious men were said to be outnumbered by the French from something like 4-1. So it gives this impression of this huge, magnificent, but unlikely defeat. But recent research actually suggests that the numbers were a lot closer. But shipwrecks are time capsules. and they can provide a factual window into life at the time of sinking. So wrecked warships may actually be able to improve the accuracy of the historic record by providing new information, expanding our understanding of the past. So for example, minefields were found to have accounted for a greater proportion of U-boat sinkings in the Battle of Jutland than we previously thought. And when the Stirling Castle was wrecked in the Great Storm of 1703 in the UK, the author who we know for his novels, Daniel Defoe, said that the townspeople had left hundreds of survivors to drown on the sandbanks while they were busy salvaging the goods of the wrecked ship. And they actually tried to sue him for libel. But the number of human remains on the wreck of the Stirling Castle that are still on the wreck actually indicates that only a few people managed to escape. So it wasn't quite the scenario that was painted by Defoe. Shipwrecks are often found in pristine condition, which makes them a fantastic source. Sir Ernest Shackleton's Endurance was discovered earlier this year in the Weddell Sea in Antarctica, over 100 years after sinking. That photo still blows my mind. It's absolutely incredible just to be able to see everything. It's almost as if it sunk yesterday. Organic material like leather, paper, they rarely survive in the archaeological context, but they're a lot more likely to be found in the anaerobic conditions of the sea, particularly if it's cold or dark or if they're buried in sediment. We've even recovered food and drink from wrecks. So that includes 600-year-old fermented fruit juice, 340-year-old cheese, which does not look very appetizing in the photos, and 170-year-old bottles of champagne that could still be drunk. I'll leave out whether I would go ahead and drink them. But in some cases, we might not know how a ship sank. So we might be able to resolve some mysteries. And the question of how a ship sank could be answered by examining the wreck itself. So when the Maine sank in 1898 in Cuba, it contributed to the outbreak of the Spanish-American War, because the media at the time reported that there was a huge explosion, the Maine split in two, and they really made it look like the Maine had been attacked. And it's often said that this is one of the starting points of yellow journalism or tabloid journalism. And investigations have since concluded that the explosion could actually have originated inside the ship. So that makes a little bit of a difference to the context at the time. It can also evidence development in either construction, munitions or warfare. And in the lead up to the First World War and during, submarine technology developed quite rapidly. And we can kind of track that by looking at the wrecks. I think a challenge to realizing historical and archaeological value is probably the incompleteness and inaccuracy of the record at the moment. In other words, we don't know what we have and where it is. There are lots of efforts going out at the moment to try and improve the record. A lot of research going on, which is fantastic to see, because there are thousands of wrecks that are yet to be identified or inventorized, and they're quickly disappearing. So archaeological coverage also tends to be quite uneven at times. And what I mean by that, it tends to be more prevalent in areas that are archaeologically accessible, whether by geography, funding, or just desire to get out there and do the work. And maritime archaeology is often quite resource heavy, so that probably doesn't help. So much of it is either done in situ, which involves being underwater for extended periods of time, or if something is recovered in highly controlled environments, that can be quite, again, resource heavy to run. So the main international law that looks at underwater heritage is the UNESCO Convention on the Protection of Underwater Cultural Heritage. And that aims to protect underwater cultural heritage, but it's only applicable for underwater heritage that has been underwater for over 100 years. So that currently excludes Second World War wrecks. So next is a communal and social value. I'm not going to read out what's on the screen, but I've put it up there just in case somebody else does. But I will just pick out some words there. So we have social well-being, a social interest of the local community, a collective memory, people's sense of identity, belonging, place. So in other words, communal and social value represent the significance of the historic environment to contemporary communities. So naturally, wrecks are less accessible than their counterparts on land, given that wrecks are mostly underwater. Not everybody dives, not everybody swims. But the communal and social value of these wrecks actually go much further beyond the physical. And in fact, social value in particular doesn't necessarily mean that there needs to be an actual link with historical value. So social value is very much tied to memory, identity, and belonging. And those tend to be intangible and intrinsic. So it might be up to the individual or the community what they find to be socially valuable, rather than somebody saying this is valuable because it is historic. So to touch on the U-Boat project again as another fantastic example, this really captured some of the impact of the war at sea on communities in Wales. And these stories do create links between communities, past and present, and they're really woven into the fabric of our social relationships, even when there is no family or direct community connection. So this photo is of Beryl Mackers. She's John Freeman's daughter, showing her father's documents here. And John came to Wales in 1915, serving on merchant ships during the war. And this is one of the stories of the black merchant seamen from Tiger Bay. And this was a tribute in the U-Boat project. And an estimated 1,000 black seamen from Cardiff alone were killed at sea during the war. And many who survived settled in Bute Town area of Cardiff, and their stories are now very much part of the social fabric of Wales. So we can clearly see how these wrecks can have that kind of value. And I think a benefit to realising that social and community value of getting people to realise and see and identify with that value is that it can incentivise communities to participate themselves in the management of these wrecks. And so we can get them to be better conserved. It might offer an additional layer of protection. It comes back to that thing of we protect what we care about. So if the community cares, then they might want to protect it. These wrecks can also improve social well-being. So for example, helping wounded veterans with their recovery through diving projects. So Historic England worked with Help for Heroes and Wessex Archaeology a few years ago to help wounded veterans to dive the Montague. We have one of the pictures here. So really trying to help social well-being through diving wrecked warships. We also have an environmental value, and we might be getting into some of the values that perhaps some of you might not have considered previously. So shipwrecks are artificial reefs, making them valuable habitats for marine species, and in some cases, really rare species. The photo here happens to be a German U-boat lost in the Battle of the Atlantic, so just off the American coast. And in fact, recent research actually shows that some predators like sharks actually prefer artificial reefs to natural habitats. They tend to prefer it in some instances. And so some ships have even been scuttled, so sunk on purpose to create these habitats. They can also be really valuable for particularly in terms of very old shipwrecks as an ecological memory. So these old shipwrecks might have layers and layers of sediment, and that allows scientists to investigate how these artificial reefs and organisms form over thousands of years. So that can be quite useful, being able to track an ecosystem developing over a millennia. They can also create biodiversity in a strange sense. So there's evidence that some historic wooden shipwrecks can help disperse microbial film. So these are communities of microorganisms that can stick to surfaces and grow in the deep sea. And historic shipwrecks, wooden shipwrecks, are really useful for that. And these microorganisms, this biofilm eventually grows, giving us biodiversity. But the marine environment can also threaten wrecked warships. So, for example, some marine species damage the archaeological integrity of wrecks, as you can see in this first photo here. So as seas are getting warmer, shipworm species are being found in waters where we haven't really been seeing them before. For example, the black tip shipworm is usually found in the Mediterranean, but we're seeing it more and more in the UK, causing havoc on ships. To give an example of what shipworm can do, when the Mary Rose was raised, around half of her structure had been eaten away by shipworm and kind of other wood-boring organisms. So it can be really, really destructive for wooden shipwrecks. But even in non-marine environments, invasive zebra and quagga mussels have been found in the Great Lakes of the US. So this is a shipwreck in Thunder Bay in Lake Huron, which is one of the Great Lakes. And they are prolific breeders. They can grow quickly and cover shipwrecks, which makes recording and conservation really, really difficult. I'll just grow the photo a little bit there so you might be able to see them a bit better. And they breed so much their collective weight can actually collapse more fragile shipwrecks. And scientists now believe that they can actually create this bacteria that corrodes metal. So that's bad news for metal shipwrecks and also wooden wrecks that are held together by metal clips or fasteners. And because of increased CO2 emissions, oceans are getting warmer, they're getting more acidic. And these increased temperatures, as we've already discussed, they encourage invasive species to warmer waters, but they also increase corrosion of steel and iron. So acidic seawater can also strip away the protective layer of concretion that forms when rest and salt water interact. So you might have seen shipwrecks with a kind of a concrete type layer all over it, almost. In some cases, you can't distinguish the shape of the wreck. That can actually be quite protective. Acidic waters might cause that to be stripped away. And with that gone, iron hulls and metal fasteners, again, that hold wooden shipwrecks could disintegrate. So without anything holding the wooden shipwrecks together, we might end up with piles of wood. So climate change also increases extreme weather events, and that impacts exposure and erosion of underwater sites that are in intertidal areas. So while archaeological wood can survive for centuries in anoxic environments with kind of little to no oxygen, it can deteriorate quite rapidly when it's re-exposed to oxygen. So instances have been reported internationally, but also in the UK. So this photo happens to be the SV Carl. It's a German World War I wreck in Cornwall. This wreck has been kind of covered and uncovered over the years from time to time, but this is the first time in this particular storm that it was almost completely uncovered. So we are seeing a lot more instances of these extreme weather events impacting heritage that might usually be buried or underwater. There are also other human threats, human-caused threats in the marine environment, like oil spills, for example. Exposure to oil from the 2010 Deepwater Horizon oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico, which you can see here, this was taken from space. So to give you an idea of how big this actually was, that could have ongoing impacts on the preservation of German subs in the area, such as U-166. And research has actually showed that corrosion of that particular submarine had accelerated due to the oil spill. So there might also be dangers lurking in the marine environment. But in some cases, shipwrecks can be the danger, and they can be environmental hazards. So some wrecked warships carry bunker fuel or cargo oil, and they're, as their metal hulls are slowly corroding over time, naturally, but also accelerated because of threats that we've discussed on the previous slide, they could give way and release a flood of oil into the sea. So many of these ships have been slowly leaking oil for quite a number of years. The picture here is the Coimbra. It's the Second World War tanker, British tanker, just off the coast of New York. And it carried around 2.7 million gallons of oil at the time. Much of this has been pumped out, but as you can see, some still exists, and it is leaking oil, slowly creating this kind of oil slick. We seem to have avoided a big catastrophe up to now, but that could be a big threat, so that needs to be addressed. There might also be unexploded munitions on board a ship. So one of the most controversial has been the Second World War era Richard Montgomery. This is just a mile and a half from the UK coast. You can see just about the tip of its masts just behind the danger sign there. And that carries 1,400 tons of explosives. Now, if that structure collapses, it could really trigger an explosion. So there have been discussions over quite a number of years now to move the masts so they don't put strain on that structure without needing to. And the First World War Castilian is also wrecked off the coast of Anglesey, and that is one of the dangerous wrecks that we have, again, in the UK. So you see that warning sign there. So wrecks might also carry chemical weapons or cargoes. They might have mercury or mustard gas, for example. And there have been reports of mercury leaks from several warships in the UK, around Norway. And in seawater, mercury can be converted by chemical process into monomethyl mercury. And that's a neurotoxin that can be quite harmful to marine and human life. So as you can imagine, if fish ingest it, it's quite harmful. If humans ingest, again, that fish, that can be quite harmful. And the presence of wrecks, even though they're really good habitats for some species, could also be really negative for other species. So iron dissolved in seawater, as might happen around the iron shipwrecks, attracts an aggressive reef-dwelling sea anemone, and that causes it to grow massively. It kind of gets its strength from this dissolved iron. And in the Palmyra Atoll Reserve in the Pacific, this sea creature covered over 2 miles of the seabed. It smothered the coral and decimated the reef's ecosystem. This is what we call a black reef phenomenon, where all the other coral almost dies off. It's taken over by one species and it makes it look black. So it's dominated by a single species. Once this wreck was removed, the sea creature naturally sort of eventually died off. And high iron concentrations have been discovered in other shipwreck sites where there have been instances of black reefs. And so that could cause issues. There are possible legal issues around liability here as well. If there's a big oil spill, if there is an explosion or leaking chemicals, or if a reef is decimated, who's liable for that? To who? So there's different questions that need to be resolved there. Who owns the shipwreck? Who has title? Causation issues. Was the shipwreck abandoned? Was title transferred? Things that I'm not really going to get into tonight. However, there's interesting ones there. And also the other challenge noted in when we looked at archaeological value, which was identifying these shipwrecks. So knowing where they are and what they're carrying, I think that's really important. And that's going to be important work as part of ongoing research to create an inventory of these wrecks. So coming to our last couple of values, economic and commercial value, shipwrecks have significant economic value. They can boost tourism, spend in local economies. They attract divers to visit to diving trails. Many of you might be divers and you know how that goes. And the Nautical Archaeological Society, NAS, actually reported that visitors to the site of Coronation, which is a protected wreck, contributed over 42,000 to the local economy in 2012. And that's just one wreck in one year. So just one statistic as an example. So they can be really useful in boosting tourism to certain areas. And they can also make really good diving opportunities to see a diverse range of fish. That again attracts divers to the area. So even divers that might not want to see wrecks for whatever reason, there's plenty of fish to see. Or even tourists that are on holiday, kind of not necessarily diving holidays, but snorkeling. So Palau in the Pacific, for example, is really well known for its collection of World War II shipwrecks. And it's really diverse marine life, and that has attracted divers from all over the world. And tourism is one of the significant factors in Palau's economy. So if not the most significant. If wrecks or artifacts are recovered and conserved in museums, those too could generate income. So this, for example, is the Mary Rose Museum. The Mary Rose in the Mary Rose Museum. And that museum has received over 10 million visitors since opening to the public in 1983. So you can imagine, I'm sure that Mary Rose is a very, I think there's a lot of interest around the wreck anyway. Again, it goes to show the commercial economic contribution of these wrecks. Because shipwrecks attract fish, it might also be a value to fishermen. So wreck fishing is a big thing, especially if you're fishing for cod, pollock, conger eels in the UK. So that they're useful spots in that sense. And there are a lot of companies that offer fishing trips and wreck diving. And so again, creating money for local businesses, local economy. So wrecks do contribute to economic sustainability. They improve the quality of the economy. They facilitate employment, boost local economies and businesses. And specifically, and I suppose this is a very specific economic value, but in developing states, they might be eligible to apply for international climate-related funding. And these funding pots helps developing states to run projects or to run activities that help them adapt to a changing climate. So historic shipwrecks could be seen as a climate adaptation priority by these states because of the threat that that climate change poses to them and because of the value that they have in terms of supporting sustainability. So that then unlocks potential to get this ring-fenced funding for kind of heritage climate-related capacity-building activities in some developing countries. But value as commercial commodities can also threaten shipwrecks. So treasure salvage is a really poor business plan, but there have been some big payoffs for salvers, and particularly in US courts. So Treasure Salvers Inc. Was a salvage company that recovered the wreck of a Spanish galleon off the coast of Florida in 1985. They found a huge, huge cargo of gold and emeralds, probably the biggest haul ever. And I think photo one is a replica of some of that gold. But the total find stretched into the hundreds of millions of dollars. And after a lengthy court battle with the state of Florida, the salvers were awarded rights to all the treasure that they had found. And so I suppose this type of story does incentivize some salvers. So salvage law is obviously quite relevant here. Salvage law allows a salver to claim an award if they satisfy certain criteria. And the UNESCO convention that I mentioned earlier actually tries to limit the operation of salvage law in relation to historic wrecks, because of the commercialization of this type of thing, that salvage law incentivizes this type of activity. The ship itself might also be of economic value, and many First and Second World War wrecks have already been desecrated for scrap metal. I think at least 65% of World War I wrecks from the Battle of Jutland show signs of unauthorized commercial salvage activity. So the Queen Mary, seen afloat here, has been extensively salvaged and damaged, even though she's the resting place of over 1,200 personnel that died aboard her. And in the last few years, several World War II wrecks have disappeared completely from the Java Sea, again, because they've been salvaged for metal, with reports that salvors have even recovered human remains from the wrecks. Some wrecks might also be valuable as commodities to souvenir hunters and collectors. So when the location of German U-boat 701 became known in 2004, for example, the wreck was pillaged. Salvors took antenna, shells, the periscope, the deck gun. Another similar story is U-85 sunk in the Second World War, and only one of 24 submarines of her kind ever made. And the inside has now completely been dredged of almost all contents, and any loose artifacts that were on the seabed have been picked clean by souvenir hunters. But other economic activities not intentionally directed at shipwrecks can also threaten wrecks. So some fishing practices can be quite destructive, like blast fishing, for example, where fishermen use explosives to either stun or kill fish, making them a lot easier to catch. And of course, if that is near shipwrecks, they can get damaged in the process. A lot of World War II wreck sites in Micronesia in the Pacific have been affected. But trawling nets can also damage fragile wrecks and make diving more dangerous and making it harder to survey. And trawlers can also break the structures of wrecks and drag up or scatter artifacts. And other economic activity might include seabed activity like aggregate dredging, where sand or gravel is collected to be used as building materials, or oil and gas exploration or pipeline laying, and shipping can even be a threat. So there was, it was found that an anchor from a really large commercial ship had been found to have been dragged through the wreck of the HMS Invincible. And finally, we have our scientific value. So it's a real source of scientific data. Shipwrecks can provide important ecological metrics, and that improves our understanding of ecosystem processes. So using sonar on the ocean floor gives us a lot of information about the seabed environment and things like sediment movement, how everything works. Where there are shipwrecks on the seabed, we can also get data on how those shipwrecks influence physical processes in the ocean. So how currents move around them and how they interact with sediment, for example. We can then use that information for the development of green energy projects like wave and tidal resources. So in other words, we better understand how the ocean reacts when things are placed on the seabed. So if we need to place objects that relate to green energy development, we have a better idea of how that interaction would work. They can also provide really good data for how we might adapt to extreme weather events. For example, the remains of an ancient Swahili community was discovered beneath a 1,000-year-old sand layer in Tanzania a few years ago. And the cause of this sand layer was found to be tsunami activity. And that indicated that teletsunamis, so massive tsunamis from the Sumatran Andaman zone, which was where the big Indian Ocean tsunami originated, could be a real threat to the eastern coast of Africa, because it indicated that 1,000 years ago, this had happened before. And before this discovery, tsunami risk was considered to be quite low in East Africa. So this knowledge could now be really useful in planning for future events that could come up. And finally, the physical wreck itself also has some scientific value as a source of low background steel. Low background steel is steel that was produced prior to the detonation of nuclear bombs. So that means it's not contaminated with radioactive material, as is steel produced after 1945. Now, this radioactivity is getting less and less as time goes on. However, it's still used in some radiation sensitive equipment where it's really needed, like guide counters or equipment for space exploration or even medical devices. And the biggest source of this steel is safely away from this radiation under the sea. So it's shipwrecks from the First and Second World War, and they're often salvaged for that purpose. So the last two slides in bringing this to a close, and there are some legal challenges, and I thought I would better step away from some of the more interesting historic stuff and look at some of the still interesting legal stuff. So here are some of the challenges that may face historic shipwrecks and kind of realization of these values. That it's a mixture of public and private law that are historic shipwrecks are subject to. And without going into much detail, public law is the law between the state and the persons or the public. So they might touch upon things like environmental stuff or protecting heritage. Private law are rights and obligations between individuals. So very much private affairs, businesses and companies also looking at things like ownership, title, sale of goods. So this real tension already between public and private law that we don't get in a lot of other areas of law, actually. We've also got different layers of laws to work through that might be applicable in different scenarios. So there's the international law. We have the Convention on Underwater Cultural Heritage, which is probably the main one really that's directed at underwater heritage. We have the Law of the Sea Convention, which is the most ratified, so most countries have signed up to it. But we also have international environmental law, the law of armed conflict, state immunity. So all of these have to interact together. And so there are questions on how those interact together in the question of historic wrecks. European law, we have the Valletta Convention on Archaeological Heritage. Then we have UK law, where we have also a split of public and private. The Merchant Shipping Act, Protection of Military Remains, Protection of Wrecks Act, Ancient Monuments. And then we have the devolved law, where a lot of the UK law will also be applicable, but there might be differences in law, policy and approaches because heritage is a devolved issue. And finally, we have gaps in regulation. So not all states have ratified and so implemented the UNESCO Convention, which probably offers the best protection for these wrecks at the moment. The UK has not ratified it. And because of this, domestic approaches of different countries can really differ. So there is no guarantee that wrecks will be treated the same or even well everywhere. And if states haven't ratified the UNESCO Convention, then there will be geographical gaps in the ocean for the protection of underwater heritage. So protection may really depend on where in the ocean wrecks are located. And in any case, international waters, the high seas are really, really difficult to police. As you can imagine, they're just so expansive. It's really difficult to police, and it's almost reactive where an archaeologist might go to a wreck for surveying or recording and only then find that it has been kind of pillaged or cleaned out by salvors, or it has been affected in other ways. So for the last slide, I wanted really something to bring this all together and just to show how challenging this actually is. I played about with Venn diagrams for a little while, but I suppose there is a good reason why I'm not a scientist or an expert in data, and I thought I would stick to the law. So I came up with this hypothetical scenario, and this is the shipwreck in my hypothetical scenario, which is the Titanic, of course. But for tonight, this is a World War II shipwreck known to be wrecked with servicemen on board, and it's located in relatively shallow waters. This shipwreck was also carrying munitions when it sank, and there is evidence that it may be leaking oil. So how would we deal with that, our hypothetical shipwreck? How would we bring all those values and laws together just to paint a picture of kind of the complexity of this? So those that view the wreck site as a war grave might want to keep this wreck in situ, in place, and not permit any interference. So that might cause us to look at domestic law, maybe protection of military remains if we're in the UK, maybe the law of armed conflict if we're looking at military graves broadly. Those that see its archaeological and historical value might also want to preserve it in situ, making sure that it preserves its archaeological integrity, that you have you can better guarantee its contextual value, but they also might want to carry out surveys or excavations. We would normally look to the UNESCO Convention, perhaps, but this is a Second World War shipwreck, so it might not be even applicable in this instance. And in terms of human remains, the UNESCO Convention does consider them to be cultural property, so remains can also be viewed as cultural heritage. Given its accessibility in relatively shallow waters, it could be a popular diving location that brings tourism into the local area. So again, we might want to keep it in situ for that reason. Or salvors might believe that steel or artifacts from the shipwreck have economic value and want to excavate it. So then things like the Law of the Sea Convention or salvage law might come into play. As it's a wrecked warship, the state might want to also prevent access to the site. Though if it contains munitions, which it seems to be carrying munitions, and it's in shallow waters and it's leaking oil, it could also pose safety and environmental risks. So there might be issues with sovereign immunity and having to look at environmental law. If the state has transferred ownership of the wreck sometime after sinking, we don't know from our example, there might also be another owner, and that could complicate matters even further. So we might have to look at private property law. And if the wreck is a habitat for marine life or provides useful climate or weather or climate data, it could be again beneficial to keep it in situ. So we might be trying to look at some relevant biodiversity laws or climate law and policy. So I suppose, which of these values and associated legal regimes should take priority? And that is the challenge with a lot of historic shipwrecks. So state-owned shipwrecks have many diverse values that often come into direct conflict with each other. They're a finite, non-renewable resource, and that can lead to significant tension and dispute in respect of prioritisation. Like a lot of heritage, once they're gone, they're gone. So we really need to be able to make the best decisions that we can. Prioritising different heritage values is key in decision making, but the subjectivity of that may make things quite difficult, particularly as I would argue there's no unified objective framework that exists to support those decisions, certainly not on an international level. And value prioritisation will almost certainly depend on the circumstances of individual cases. Different ships might have different values. So that could be quite resource heavy for prioritization. And even values of really similar wrecks could be prioritized differently depending on the circumstances. So for example, in recent years, as many as 23 sunken German World War II shipwrecks are being assessed from the removal from the Danube because of risks to navigation. So as these values can be generally associated with different legal regimes or principles, as we've just discussed, that means that there's also tension between these different legal frameworks as questions of prioritisation arise. So there's questions about how those legal regimes would interact together, which of those would take priority. I think value has a big role to play in that. But I suppose the prioritisation of legal regimes is a subject for another talk, or some might even say subject for a book. So diolch yn fawr iawn i chi am rando. I think that takes us a little bit later than I'd hoped, right to the end of 7:30. But I'm very happy to stick around for a while if anybody has any questions.
Well, joking about Hayley, I'm scores diddorol iawn. Thanks, Hayley, for a really, really, really interesting talk. I gloi, hoffwn ddiolch yn fawr i chi am yn ymuno â ni heno, i Stafford Commission am drefnu, ac yn olaf, diolch yn fawr iawn i chi, Hayley, am sgwrs ddiddorol iawn. Thanks, everybody, for joining us tonight, and thanks also to the Commission staff who have been involved with the arrangements, and of course to Hayley for a fascinating talk. Nos da.